Oh, thank you very much, ma'am. All righty, here we go. I've been to Romamu, I've been to BJ. I searched all over for a place to pray. I found the mosh pit and knew that this was it. I am a moshnik and I'm here to stay. And I'm turning gray. Found community that is in tune with me. Singing and dancing in our Zoom. Pay no attention to those mistakes on the screen. Contemplation mixed with elation. I am a moshnik and I'm here to stay. And I'm turning gray. Chance to meet you, a chance to greet you, a time to deepen what it means to belong. Let's have some fun tonight and spread some joy and light. I am a moshnik and I'm here to stay. And I'm turning gray. Let's hear from Hoff. Even in Vermont, he sends his harmonica winging its way through the ones and zeros into our Zoomagog. All right, that's enough of that. Welcome, everybody. We are going to have some fun tonight. I've got so many buttons pushing right in front of me. Welcome, Irapel, Stephen. I'm really excited to be rereading, I don't know for the how many teenth time, Alan Lews, Zichronot Levracha, his fantastic book. This is real and you are completely unprepared. How many of you have the book by your side, either in Kindle form or in the actual book? I should actually ask, how many of you do not have it with you? Okay, Haiti, sit in the corner. Just joking. Okay, you know, you don't really need the book because I'm going to be reading parts of it and the conversation, which is what tonight is going to be, will keep you informed about what's happening in the book. Welcome, Gail. Welcome, Judy. You won't be missing out on anything, but I do suggest that you do get it because we're going to be doing this every week. For 7 weeks leading up, well, it's probably 6 weeks now. Tell me not to hyperventilate that Yamim Noraim are so close, alrighty? Because I have yet to begin to start preparation, but I'm doing that with you tonight. So here is some of my ideas for how this is all going to transpire. Number one, I don't see this so much as a quote unquote teaching, but more of a conversation, right? So what I mean by that, oh, I still have the spotlight. I'm gonna take my spotlight off and I'm gonna make Deborah Lisk, where are you, in case I fail to, let me see, am I gonna make you the co-host? There we go. Now you got the power. As I was saying, I would love this to be more of a conversation than giving over of great wisdom on my part, because as you know, I'm going to be hopefully channeling Rabbi Lew and reading directly from his book and stopping many, many times for all the times that you raise your hand or you just interrupt me with a comment, with a teaching, with an observation, with a reflection, with something that you already have learned from this book. I know my friend Reb Deb. Where'd you go? There you go. Deb Smith has taught this, has read this, and some other of you might have also done that. And so I'm going to rely on your wisdom to lend itself to this holy conversation. Alrighty, so please take me at my word. Raise your hand virtually or just, you know, gesticulate, you know, so you get my attention here on the screen at any time. What else did I want to tell you? And like I said, we're going to be, I'm not sure how many chapters we're going to sign every week. Why don't you just read ahead? And I would say that two chapters a week won't even get us to the end. So read as much as you can, but focus and make notes on the next two chapters for next week, which I will be leading from North Bend, Washington at my son Zach's house, because I'm going to visit my son on Sunday. Alrighty, before we begin, any questions, observations, any? Yes, Scott, I knew there was a troublemaker out there somewhere. Go ahead.
You're right, because your email said to read the forward in chapter one, and
that's right.
Don't forward.
There was no forward?
No.
Oh, do you have a Kindle or you have the book?
I have a real book.
That is weird. Well, maybe there were different editions. Well, I'm looking at a Kindle edition.
Roxanne says no also, right? Because she has the same one I do.
Okay, don't worry about it.
Must have been an earlier edition.
The forward is written by Norman Fisher.
Oh. Okay.
And who was dear friends with the late Alan Lew of blessed memory. And Norman Fisher never quite made his way back from the Buddhist world, although maybe it's better said that he fully immersed himself in that, and is a very knowledgeable Jew as well. And we're going to be taking a look, and I'll read through some of these things. So not to worry, Scott, and anyone else who does not have the forward. Anyone else have anything that you want to interject at this time before we jump into the deep end together? Okay, then without further ado, a story. How else would I begin, right? This story, actually, for your consideration, Scott, and anyone else who doesn't have the forward, is alluded to by Norman Fisher. And it's a story that you all know and have heard many, many times. And what is the story about is the story that, first of all, it appears in the treasure, it's called The Treasure. It appears in Martin Buber's book, Tales of the Hasidim, and it is about Reb Isaac, son of Reb Yechel, and it takes place in Krakow. And Reb Isaac has a dream that repeats itself three times. And what is in the dream? Any, this sound familiar to anyone? He dreams that a voice tells him to make his way from his town of Krakow and to go to Prague, that underneath the bridge, making its way to the emperor's home, a castle, is a great treasure. He should go dig it up. Now, so you must understand that Reb Isaac lives in poverty, and he's never, ever lost his faith in Hashem. And he also knows when things come in threes that you need to pay attention. And so this is exactly what he does. And he goes to Prague and he finds the overpass leading to the castle, but it is heavily guarded and he doesn't dare to start digging up underneath that bridge. So he doesn't know what to do. And every night he returns until finally he is noticed. He's noticed by a guard who asks Reb Isaac, no? Well, he probably didn't say no. But he did say to him, what are you doing? I see you out here every night. Is there something that you need, something that I can do for you? And Reb Isaac, he fesses up. He tells him about the dream. You fool, says the guard. If I followed all of my dreams and what they tell me, I would be chasing all around the world. In fact, I had a dream. I had a dream that appeared three times to me as well, in which a crazy Reb Isaac from Krakow appeared to me and told me to go to Krakow, find this Reb Isaac, and dig up underneath his stove, and there I would find a great treasure. Well, first of all, I am, in your language, not Meshuggah, and I'm not doing that. But second of all, even if I did, if I went to Krakow, half the Jews there are named Isaac. How would I find the one that I dreamt about? It would have been impossible. So he left again. Rabbi Isaac bowed to him. And Rabbi Isaac realizes, aha. He had the dream. I had the dream. He goes home. And what does he do? Of course, he digs up underneath his stove and finds the treasure there. For how many of you is this a new story that you never heard before in your life? It's okay to admit it. Moshe and Neil, you've never heard the story? You went to Hebrew school. That's proving Hebrew school was lousy in those days too. So what does Norman Fisher point out about this story? Well, you know, you could say this is a Wizard of Oz moment, right? These are my words, not Norman Fisher's words, right? There's no place like home, right? But I'm going to read now from his foreword. But Rabbi Lew told the story differently. He says, in his version, the treasure was not buried underneath the floorboards. It was hidden almost in plain sight in the oven. Digging was not required. His approach to Jewish spirituality did not propose a quest for lost or neglected mystical knowledge. Instead, he sought the rediscovery of what Jews already had but did not appreciate. Do you hear that? I'm going to say that again because that's really important. He, meaning Rabbi Lew, sought the rediscovery of what Jews already had but didn't appreciate, the unseen depths of ordinary Jewish observance. So here, my friend, my friends, is where I got to thinking. And by the way, again, stop me anytime if you have a comment to make or reflection on something. Welcome, Mel. What occurred to me when I read that also appears a paragraph above where he tells the story, where Norman Fisher says, by the 1960s, spiritual revival eventually touched Judaism. Right? So what did that say to me? It said to me, I needed to look and find, if I could, any writings that would say to me that Reb Zalman and Zichronot Livracha had a link to Rabbi Alan Lew. Did anybody wonder about that? Yes, you did. Did anybody happen to look it up and find? Oh, this is great. Where is this? I put this aside and I really wanted to read this. And so what did I do with it? Maybe I hid something from myself. Give me just a second, because I really want to find it. Did somebody have their hand up? I hope so. So you can talk while I'm looking. No, okay. So talk amongst yourselves just for 1 minute. Oh, look at that. Let's see if I can find. Oh, great. Yeah, I couldn't find it. Okay. It disappeared. It's probably on my desktop somewhere. But there is a wonderful interview with leaders from the Reform Movement. Okay, not there. All righty. I closed it. Slicha. See, this is the season that begins of asking for forgiveness, so I'm already beginning in the high holiday mood. So several people talk, and one is Rabbi Rachel Cowan, who is the head of the Institute for Jewish Spirituality. And the other, is Theodore Bekel. Ready? And I'll pull this up for next time. But Theodore Bekel makes the point, it's in a conversation about where do you turn to first to prepare yourselves for Yamim Noraim, to prepare yourselves for the days of awesomeness. And Theodore Bekel talks about Reb Zalman. Theodore Bekel, also blessed memory. And he talks about how Reb Zalman made everything real for him, that you can almost taste the days leading up to it in the preparation that he would do around the themes of forgiveness. Rabbi Rachel Cowan then moves on to say that the what she goes to right away, in contrast to Theodore Bekele, who went to Reb Zalman's writings and remembering Reb Zalman and what he had to teach about all of this, Rachel Cowan goes to Alan Lew's book. She shares that when she was a Jew by choice, and in her travels, when she had already made conversion, she went to Israel and really fell in love with all the rituals and totally embraced Tisha B'Av, the day of mourning that we observed on Saturday night, Sunday. But after a while, it seemed to her to be an ancient ritual that had no meaning for her. Perhaps it's happened to some of you. And then she said she read this book and understood how Tisha B'Av was the doorway into the high holidays, that from the ashes of the destruction of the holy temples and the other calamities that befell us, she understood that this was from where she could see her newly claimed history being renewed out of the ashes, right? The phoenix rising. And she reclaimed it as a spiritual practice. And again, I promise to find this for you next week. So lo and behold, even though I couldn't find, and I'm going to call Eve Ilson, Reb Zalman's widow this week, to ask her if she knew whether there was any immediate connection between Alan Lew and Reb Zalman, to find out as close to the source as I can, and also reach out to my other colleagues. Yes, I didn't think about this till this afternoon. So this whole idea that the treasure, we don't have to go looking for it, I can only surmise that each and every one of us here in this space have been on a spiritual journey our whole lives, and some of us, me included, could very well have ended up in a different spiritual tradition. Certainly in the Buddhist tradition, I could have found myself. Because, hey, I went to Hebrew school, which means I didn't learn a thing. And I went to a conservative synagogue, which means it was dry and there was no there. And even after I was working in conservative settings as a shaliach tzibur, as a prayer leader, I still didn't have a real glimpse into Ivdu et Hashem b'simcha, serve God with joy, which I learned from being immersed in the Hasidic teachings of Jewish renewal, which I learned at the feet of Reb Zalman's students, some of whom I right here with us today. We are in the lineage of. And so this spiritual revival eventually touching Judaism that is in the foreword that Norman Fisher is alluding to, Reb Zalman was there, Reb Shlomo was there, Karlbach, Zichronot Livracha, and of course Alan Lew later in San Francisco as well. Although I believe by the time he was the head of a very large conservative shul there, the House of Love and Prayer was already kaput. So I mentioned that I'm using the Kindle edition, so I can't tell you with the book what page we're on. So as I go from page to page, if someone with a book would just jump in and call out a page number or put it in the chat, I would be grateful for that. I'm on page 2 now in the Kindle, where it says towards the bottom, "This is real," meaning the book, "is a compelling work of Neo-Hasidism," which of course is who we are as well in Minyan Oneg Shabbat. We are in that lineage. "Bringing Judaism's deepest existential wisdom, so long lost to many of us, into the confusion of our troubled postmodern moment." Basically, he's saying that we too now have access to the psycho-spiritual teachings that were brought to us by the Hasidic masters. And we are updating them as we speak, including borrowing from other traditions and sometimes from popular culture as well. And you know me, I like to do that. In the paragraph above that, none of starts with, it's towards the end of a sentence, none of us, he tells us, is ready for the reality of our fragile lives. And yet we can't avoid it. For Rabbi Lew, God is necessary, as real as our lives, and the high holidays mark that potent time in the Jewish year when the God encounter is moving, mandatory, and heartbreaking. I think I once shared with you that in her later years, I would have conversations with my mom about God. My mom lived to 98. So she must have been in her 90s sometimes when I sat down with her and I asked her, Mom, what is God to you? And her answer didn't surprise me. Her answer was, God is an idea, it's a concept. Okay, talk a little bit more. So it's something we pray to. So clearly for my mom, and I knew the answer would be something similar to this, there was no relationship between her and divinity in the way that I have cultivated that, in the way that many of you work in your spiritual practices to cultivate that. So when he says a God encounter that is moving, mandatory, and heartbreaking, this is a stopping point for many people. Because first of all, God language, God existence, who God, where God, what God, if God, we get caught up in language, in God language, right? And instead of asking the question, when do you sense the presence of the divine, of awe, of something greater than the sum of its parts, we're asking the wrong questions, right? If we ask about, do you believe in God? So this sentence here, that God is moving, mandatory, and heartbreaking in his introduction. If you get there and like, that's not you, well, forget it. We can't go any further. But since we are together on this, we are going to continue further to chapter one. So we're done with the forward, and we are on page 6 in the Kindle edition, which begins with Buckminster Fuller students asking him. I'm not reading from that paragraph, but that's, you get an idea of where we are. Stephen Berkey, welcome, my friend. Any questions, comments, reflections on where we've been so far? And it's clearly, you know, an hour and 15 minutes is not going to be enough time to get through all of the chapter, but we'll do our best. Thank you, Meira. Page 6 in the book. Well, okay, so far we're on the parallel track. Anyone? I'm looking for hands. No? If not, we'll continue on. And by the way, is it Geneva or Geneva? Chark?
None of the above. It's Geneva.
Geneva. Ah, beautiful. I should have known that. It sounds like a beautiful phrase that, what's his name? Donovan sang, oh, Geneva, Juniper. See, I told you, you don't know me. Now you get to know me through my Mishigas. All right, so we're on chapter one. He's already talked about Freud. And later in that paragraph, but Judaism came to say that beneath this appearance of conflict, multiplicity, and caprice, there was a oneness. Singularity, all-powerful and endlessly compassionate, endlessly just. And a couple of sentences before, Judaism came into the world to bring the news that the invisible is more important than the visible, right? Perhaps for some of us, this recalls that very famous Midrash of Abraham. Why is Abraham chosen? Why does God say to Abraham, you know, Lech Lecha? And of course, there's many stories about Abraham that do not appear in the Torah text itself, but the Midrash says that he's walking along one day and he sees a building on fire, and it's being consumed. And with flames shooting out of the open windows, he wonders to himself, there must be a master of this house. There must be a master of this house. And so he understands that there is an underlying unity behind and in the invisible and yet sensed world that we live in, right? Before our ancestors came upon this understanding and embraced this, of course, there were many gods, many cultures. There was a god of rain. I don't know about you, for those of you who are in the Washington, D.C. area, we just had a big, big storm here, right? So, and especially, you know, at the time of year, Sukkot, you know, we're going to need rain to water the crops. And so praying for rain made a lot of sense, but not to a god of rain, but to the God who causes the rain to fall. So a primal cause, perhaps, if you want to think in philosophical terms. Alrighty. In the visible world, we live out our routine and sometimes messy lives, etc., etc., etc. If the purpose of ritual is to render the invisible visible, then what is the profound, universal, unseen, and unspoken reality that all of this ritual reflects? What journey of the soul, what invisible journey of transformation does all of this make visible? On this journey, our soul will awaken to itself. On this journey, our soul will awaken. Hitori, hitori, awake, awake, right? This is not just these 7 weeks. And then the Yamim Noraim followed by Chag Sukkot and all the rest. This is all the time, right? This is happening in real time, to quote my friend and colleague and teacher, Rabbi Sean Zevet, right? It's happening right now, both internally, externally, through the cycles of the seasons and the cycles within us, our lives, as mapped in the 42 stopping places along the journey, which we just read about in Parshat Maaseh, right? Again, this is real and we are completely unprepared, but we're preparing ourselves. On this journey, our soul will awaken to itself, right? So what do we do at night? We put the soul in safekeeping. Biado afkid ruchi, v'yeti shan v'yaira. V'im ruchi gaviyati adonai li v'lo ira. At the end of Adon Olam, we're probably fast asleep by we get to counting that sheep. That makes sense, what I just said. You know, we're in the bedtime Shema, you know, Shema Bamita. It's very long. And if you actually do it and you get to Adon Olam and get through Adon Olam, you probably need to take something to help you sleep, because that's a long time. But as you know, because we end our services on Shabbat morning with Adon Olam, at night we say, we're going to entrust my soul, going to put it in safekeeping and in the storage house that belongs to divinity. And in the morning, you know, you returned my soul to me. You know, you opened up the soul treasure house. And now what's my job? What's my job? What's your job? Is to allow the soul light to get in, to enter, so that it awakens to itself, to its unique, beautiful, never before created and never before will seen again self. Well, maybe for the next Gilgul, the next incarnation, but not during this one. That's why when I'm singing Mode Ani sometimes on Shabbos morning, I say, wake up, wake up. Not just for you, it's for me too. And so this process that he is sharing with us and illuminating with us about the 7 weeks, which is all the time, it's like a giant hologram, is for us to wake up and smell the roses. It is further on down in that paragraph, still on page 7, it is the journey from little mind to big mind, from confinement in the ego to a sense of ourselves as a part of something larger. And for those of you who were with me this afternoon for our meditation that made use of Avraham Ablafia's meditation technique, which is all about awakening the prophetic ability that lies dormant in each of us, this is exactly what he's talking about. The movement from Moachin de Katnut, from small mind, narrow mind, to Moachin de Gadlut, spacious mind, right? The letting go of everything so there's no schmutz on the front window so you can see your path clearly as possible. While doing what? Going back to last Shabbos, having a clear view of the rear view mirror as well. Remember that? So all is clear, right? It is perfect. All is clear. You are loved. And all is, and I am holy. Drawing from Reb Zalman. And then finally, talking about Adon Olam, the journey from little mind to big mind, two lines later, this is the journey on which we discover ourselves to be part of an inevitable chain of circumstances, the journey beyond death, the journey home. Which is why our Sidur is called Finding Our Way Home. And why Shulamit every week says, if I knew the way, I would take you home. God willing, she knows her way and discovers her way. And we all need to discover our own unique way to get there. I'm going to take a breath and a little bit of Two Cents Plain to give you a chance to ask any questions. As my father would say, was good. Questions, comments, reflection. Nothing. Okay. All right. I'm going to assume either you can't hear a word I'm saying and you're just humoring me, or that this is resonating in such a deep, holy place that you can't find the words. On the next page, page 9, it alludes to what I was just referring to. In the ancient Israel, the 7th month of the year was an anxious time, right? All the other civilizations of the nation, ancient Near East, were sustained by great rivers. Isn't this interesting? In those days, those nations were sustained by great rivers, and these days, those nations are sustained by great underground reserves of oil. That's yeah, the land of promise, there was supposed to be something different there, I suppose. But it also made us completely dependent upon rain. The rains came in the 8th month, so the 7th month was a time when the nation of Israel felt its life hanging in the balance, and an experience of a vast interpenetrating whole, a cosmos in which the weather and their own moral condition were active and interdependent constituents. Now that's a mouthful, but I think what he is not so secretly alluding to is the understanding, the Jewish mystical understanding, and not so mystical if it's only, I guess it's only mystical if you don't see it as being real and practical, but it can be both. You know, Chagall talked about that. That anyone who uses the terms metaphor and illusion don't understand the nature of reality. And of course, Chagall is painting, you know, fiddlers flying over houses, et cetera, et cetera, and lovers suspended over the ground. I think what he's talking about here is the intersection of Israel's clinging, dveikus, dveikut, to the word of our God, whatever that means to you, and the fact that we can affect the Godhead through prayer and action and tzedakah. So that might resonate with you, what I just said, because that's part at the end of who by fire, right? Miva eshu, miva mayim. It's going to say, tzedakah, tshuva, tefillah, amarivin et roha, hagazera. That prayer, tzedakah, and teshuvah can all alter or lessen the severity of the decree written into the book of life and death. So that we can alter things by our actions and our holy intent. And all of this is interdependent and interpenetrating one to the other. I'm going to page 10. And I'm going to ask a question that is going to count on you to raise your hand and offer your reflection on. He says, if there was no consciousness out there aware of us, right? If there were no consciousness out there aware of us, and remind me to hold up Reb Zalman's teaching about the difference between yira and pachad. If there were no consciousness out there aware of us, responding to us, this whole round of holidays would make no sense at all, and neither would life. Okay, my friends, here's my question. What is he saying? And basically what I'm asking is, what is his theology? If there were no consciousness there, aware of us, responding to us, this whole round of holidays would make no sense at all, and neither would life. Scott, please start us off.
So I need to go back one step, which is that tshuva, tefillah, and tzedakah don't make it rain.
No, it doesn't. You caught me. I wasn't really trying to make but the understanding was that it does effectuate in some world a chain reaction. Maybe.
Still doesn't make it rain. That's well, and I think which gets to your next one, which is that maybe it's just how things are now, but you know, I'm just feeling like it's hard to affect things. It's hard to have that connection.
Oy, oy, oy. Is it ever? Of course it is. Especially when we're bombarded with so much left brain thinking. It takes a certain amount of, you can call it faith, but I would call it perhaps a living the myth. And an embracing our holy paths and the sense that we're making of it as we walk it. Some of it we embrace and some of it we put aside. And those things that we put aside, sometimes it comes around again, like Carly Simon sang about, right? And then we look at it again. Mira.
So I'm not going to say that our dance for rain makes God open the clouds on our heads, but I am going to say that the energy and tension that we put into the universe changes the physics of the universe and brings it back to us. Look at Joe Dispenza. That's science, not mysticism.
Amen. And it's also deep Kabbalistic thought that the Hasidic teachers drew heavily on. Right. Yeah, I couldn't have said it better myself. Thank you. That's why we're a team. Yeah. Thank you, Meira. Yes, Linda.
I was thinking of the term, of the phrase, God is in this place and I didn't know. Mm-hmm. And I think the amount of consciousness that we bring to that idea tells how much God is present in our own lives. So from my own self, living as a cultural Jew, I wasn't aware that God could be any place. Hmm. And through study, I'm finding places that I never considered where God could be.
This is why then one of the names for God is Hamakom. Because God is the place. And maybe we should stop using the word G-O-D. Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh is the place of divinity, which is Maloch HaOlam Kavodo. The whole world is filled with this presence. And Mimale Ko Olamim V'Sovev Ko Olamim. I got a million of them, right? That the presence both surrounds and fills all creation and all worlds. So yes, absolutely. And there's many ways to enter into this sensed reality. Gratitude practice, appreciation of beauty, living in awe-ness, radical amazement. Deborah.
Well, and so the rest of his point is that if you don't believe that there is something bigger than us out there beyond us, then you can miss out on all the holidays without missing anything.
Did you use the word believe when you just spoke?
I don't know. Can you rewind? I can't remember. I think I did.
Play back the tape. Warner Wolf. Yeah. We'll see when we need him. I think you did. And I tend to shy away from the word belief. For me, the word sense, if I sense something, I can trust that more than I believe, because we can get caught up in our beliefs, which can lead to fanaticism, okay, which et cetera, at least the sinat chinam. It's a...
Well, since you said that, I'll go with it. I'm trying to not be too like out there. So, okay.
Okay, great. Meira. Abel, the other Meira. We have more Meiras per square inch. Unmute yourself, my friend.
To go back to the prayer, tzedakah, and teshuvah point, I think I read in the book that one of his points is that it doesn't necessarily change what happens, but it changes your response to what happens by the practice, by keeping your heart open. You might have the same things happen to you, but your response to it might be more loving, might be more peaceful, might be more centered. And so the practices help you with weathering, not to use a pun, but weathering the storm that of life. And I think that that's always a valuable point.
Yeah, thank you, Meira. This is exactly where we're headed towards, too, a conversation around that, which really begs us to take a look at the paragraph from the High Holidays of Huma Esha Huva Mayim, that is within Utana Tokef. So we'll get there in a moment, and at the end of that is the whole rising up of Teshuvah, Tefillah and Tzedakah, tempering the harshness of the decree. You know, these words, they cause weaker men than I to run away screaming, you know, and saying, you know, that I, you know, some people understand this of a God who is, you know, like Zeus, you know, up in heaven saying, you're in, you're out, you're dead, you're alive. That's not my sense of what's going on here. Moshe, help me out here.
So I was struck by the line on page 11 that God's mindfulness of us is a sine qua non for the holiday season. So God is conscious of us, and we must be conscious of God. And I've never really sort of heard of God being conscious of us, but that there's something else there. But it takes, you know, we've often heard we need God and God needs us. This is just an interesting way of restating that.
So I assume that you're looking at, or possibly this line, that there is in fact a transcendent consciousness out there watching us with an unbearable compassion. So it's not only that we're being watched, and even that's kind of creepy, right? Right? That if you think about it in Western terms, but this, if you think of it of a great as a greater consciousness that both fills and surrounds all creation, I can buy into that, right? I'm not buying that God disappeared during the Holocaust. Chas v'chalila, right? God was crying with us. We have free will to come together, as Reb Zalman would hope, or to destroy each other. So this transcendent consciousness, we could take this one step further with a wow about his theology, and maybe yours, that it's not neutral, this consciousness. It's watching us with unbearable compassion as we blunder through the world. I love that. Well, I don't love that we do that, but, right? As we blunder through the world, it's like we're walking in the dark, searching for the light. All righty. Three books are open on Rosh Hashanah. We're on page 12. One for the completely evil, one for the completely righteous, and one for the Beinonim, everyone in between. That's us, my friends. The completely righteous are written and sealed in the Book of Life immediately. The completely evil, the Rasha Gamur, are written and sealed in the Book of Death immediately. Now, again, these terms are problematic, the Book of Life and the Book of Death, because we know many people who are living a living death, right? Those in between stand suspended from Rosh Hashanah until Yom Kippur. If they merit it, they're written for life. If they do not merit it, they're written for death. How did one come to merit being written in the Book of Life? Four things will cause God to tear up ma'akrin, the decree of judgment which has been issued against a person. Acts of righteousness, fervent prayer, changing one's name, and changing one's behavior. Now, I hope somebody's going to say, wait. How does changing your name cause a change of the ripping up of the decree? Anybody know the answer to this? This concept? Mira, go for it. Stephen, I see you were like itching.
Go ahead, Stephen. Go ahead.
I'm just thinking about when my wife and I had infertility problems, and we changed her. He added to her name to avoid the evil decree.
Or the evil eye, as some
the evil eye
people say, right? there. Mm-hmm. So there is that. Wow, that's a wow moment. I can just continue on after that.
I had another thought about changing the name. My understanding is that in Judaism, if we go through a transformation, we take on a new name. And we get called to the Torah with a new name, which is how I am Meira in 2012.
Yes, absolutely. That's right. You are a new person. You take on a new name. Not just because you take on the new name, but some transformation has occurred, right? And whether it be through the process of teshuvah, being a Baal teshuvah, for instance, or in any number of ways of, for those of us who went through the Davenin Leadership Training Institute, like half the people seem to change their names during that whole process. And I mean, I didn't, I'm still Moshe Bear, and I still go by Mark. But a lot of people took on Hebrew names and used that in their everyday lives because something happened there that transformed them, as if their old skin, you know, there was like a shedding of old skin and a putting on of, a coat of many colors that they were able to then call themselves. And they were yearning to call themselves a new name. So I know people who went to Reb Zalman and said, I need a name. I don't know. And Reb Zalman would sit with them and kind of like reach into the kishkis metaphorically and to help them to arrive, for a name to arise from within. Deb Smith, go ahead, Reb Deb.
Well, I was thinking about changing your name, and I was thinking about a time in my life when I was looking for a name, and I had one. I'm Devorah, that was the name I was given, but I went to my rabbi at the time. And I said, I'm really looking for a name. And he said, well, you have a name. And I said, no, but I'm looking for my identity in the Jewish world. And I'm looking for who I am and how I'm going to make a mark here. And he said to me, Devorah, your namesake from the Torah, is really an important person. And he sent me home with like tons of books. I couldn't even walk out of the building with them. They were all these religious books that talked about Devorah in Jewish literature. And I started to read her and study about her and learn who she was. And I learned that I had so much in common with her because I'm a counselor and a teacher, and I wasn't yet a rabbi at that point, but I was a leader, lay leader in the Jewish community. And I started to really identify with her more so than the old grandmother's grandmother in Europe that was dressed in black that I had a picture of that I was actually named for. And it was transformative. And I had a ceremony where I took the name Devorah and I invited a lot of people, and the rabbi wrote a blessing, and there was like a whole, thing in the chapel. And I was thinking about this phrase that says changing your name and how you change the focus of how you live. And I look at those people at DLTI who took Hebrew names, and they're living in a different cycle of life. They're living in a different calendar cycle. They're living the Jewish rhythm of life. And that by saying they wanted a new name or they take a new name, they're going to work their lives differently. Hmm. They'll work the Jewish text and they'll work the Jewish calendar. And so for me, I've always learned that as I traveled more on this journey and became a rabbi, I can have great times with my friends, but my calendar is different from theirs. And, I was doing Tisha B'Av and they had no idea what I was doing or why it was important. And, they were going swimming or going to the beach. But for me, I live within a different time. And so when I think of changing a name, I think of it as part of that. Mm-hmm. Debarki, thank you.
Yeah, beautiful. This is always my favorite part of these gatherings, which is sharing our stories and how our stories intersect with the teachings, because we really discover ourselves a little more deeply in the teachings that way by sharing our stories. And I'm just assuming that there's many of you going, oh, me too, me too, me too, as something's resonating in everything that somebody says. You're talking about, I see emotion, Shosh. Deb, where'd you go? There you are. Talking about, taking on a name and then living the name, meaning that living the cycle of the Jewish year, it's kind of like claiming that. I'm going to butcher this, but it's at the beginning of the Chumash that's put out by Chabad. And it has a statement by the late Lubavitch Rabbi Menachem Schneerson, of blessed memory, in which he said, we should live according to the times. We should live according to the times. And then there's a little commentary after that. I said, well, what did he mean by that? Of course, people say some things and we have to figure out what they mean. And they said, well, what he meant was we should live according to the Parsha HaShavua. That was the time, right? That the cycle that we are living in, that's mapped on our lives, as the Baal Shem Tov teaches, right? Those are the times in which we're living in, and I never thought of the embracing and the choosing and the living within a new name in that way. So thank you for that gift, Deb. That was very meaningful for me. The Motion Show coming to a TV station near you.
Speaking of a name, and as half of the Mosh and Shosh Show. So, and I'm a student in Aleph, as some of you may know. And it's interesting, my name's Phyllis. My given name is Phyllis. Never was crazy about it. I mean, it's an okay name. It's very old fashioned now. It's fine. And that's who I've been for, you know, almost 7 decades now. But when I started with Aleph, I took on using Shoshana, which is never really given to me officially as a Hebrew name. I don't have an official one. I think a Hebrew teacher back in Aleph, grade Aleph, I mean, Kita Aleph, gave me that name. I have no idea what it relates to, except it's a rose and Phyllis is like chlorophyll, you know, PHYL. I have no idea. But anyway, I've been Shoshana. When I go to Israel, I go by Shoshana and I love the name. So many beautiful references to it. So now I have this dual identity. And as Deb Lesk is smiling, because she knows, and she met me as Phyllis, and now we're using Shosh, and I really like it. And then I was really happy to see Michael Mosh take on Mosh. I love that you call us Mosh and Shosh, or Shosh and Mosh. And I will tell you, for the first time, really was at your, as at Mosh, Mosh on Sunday, Saturday morning the other day, I felt really comfortable being Shoshana there. And I am now, God, thank God, a Bubby too. And a lot of people that are very dear to me call me Bubby. So I figured I can have multiple identities. There's nothing wrong with that. Dibarti.
Shamati. Mm-hmm. Shamati. Let's sing. And there's a reason why I want to sing now, because this is where I want to go. V'tshuva, tefila, v'tzedaka, ma'avirin et ro'a ha'gezera. Comes at the end of the very moving and filling and haunting and curiously disturbing paragraphs about who shall live and who shall die. So I'm going to pull up on my smaller screen. And for those of you who'll be with me for High Holidays, we will again use the Kohanim song, Who by Fire, interspersed with Barosh Hashanah. Barosh Hashanah yikatevu. V'yom Tzom Kippur yechateimun. V'rosh Hashanah yechateivun. V'yom Tzom Kippur yechateimun. Who by fire, sing it with me. Who by fire, who in the sunshine, who in the nighttime, who by high ordeal, who by common trial, who in your merry, merry month of May, who by very slow decay, and who shall I say is calling? Barosh Hashanah yichateivu. V'yom Tzom Kippur yechateimun. who in her lonely slip, who by barbiturate, who in these realms of love, who by something blunt, who by avalanche, who by powder, and who for his greed, and who for his hunger, and who shall I say is calling? Barosh Hashana Yichatehu, V'yom Tzonki Po Yechatehu. Rosh Hashanah it is written, and on Yom Kippur it is sealed. Barosh Hashanah Yichatehu, V'yom Tzonki Po Yechatehu. Who by brave ascent, who by accident, who in solitude, who in this mirror, who by his lady's command, who by his own hand, who in mortal chains, who in power, and who shall I say is calling? Barosh Hashanah Yichatehu, V'yom Tzom Kippur Yechatehu. And then the next page. Who shall pass away gently, whose life will be interrupted? These are unpacking of the passage by Rabbi Rami Shapiro. Who shall live, who shall die, etc., etc. On Rosh Hashanah it is written, on Yom Kippur it is sealed, who will live and who will die. But Teshuvah. And prayer and righteous deeds can transform ma'avirin, or where it says here, temper the harshness of the decree. So turning the page back just for a moment. Again, if we in Reb Zalman's understanding of some people's theology, never having moved from the pediatric understanding of God, if we're stuck in that place, we're not going to be able to deal with this paragraph in a mature way in which Alan Liu outlines on page 13. And this is where I think it was you, Meira Appel, but I might be mistaken, at the bottom of page 13, he talks about that which was decreed to happen will not in fact happen. We know that from life, right? We know that the righteous suffer and that the evil people are rewarded for their actions. And so we will understand things differently. Teshuva will not change what happens to us, rather they will change us. Wow. The liturgy makes a very different claim, namely that prayer, righteousness, and teshuva will do just that, change us. We will understand what happens differently. In other words, when I look at this long litany of things that happen in Barosh Hashanah Yichatehu, who shall live, who shall die, and how that shall happen, my sense of it is, yes, all of these things will happen to some of us. They may even happen to me, God willing or God forbid. Spiritual practice won't change what happens. Here he digs deep into his Buddhist understanding, seeing his Jewish life through this lens. Rather, it will help us to experience what happens not as evil, but simply as what happens. Spiritual practice will help us to understand that everything that happens, even the decree of death, flows from God. Life happens. Good things happen to bad people. All flows from God. And no, we don't have the power to bring down the rain, but we do have the power to transform us and be hopeful that the rains will come. Have faith that the rains will come, and if they don't, not to blame it on God. Keeping an eye on the time. Judy Young, please.
Mark, I think what you're saying right now is pertinent to this idea of interconnectedness. That, you know, all of life, all of nature, all of us are interconnected. And so all of those things that happen are going to happen to somebody. And we're impacted by it. It may not happen to us, but it happens in our world. And so I think that's where this is taking me, is to an appreciation of that interconnection of life.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure how else to get to this without that appreciation, Judy. I'm not sure how else you can arrive at spiritual practice will help us to understand that everything that happens flows from God. And spiritual practice won't change what happens unless you sense the interconnectedness of everything. Shosh Mosh and then Irigil.
Yeah, I'll try to keep it short, but I think it might be a tough question. It sparked when you said, and if the rains don't come, we don't blame God. Mm-hmm. But then why do we thank God when they do come?
I'm not going to answer the question. I think you know the answer to the question. You know, the Talmud says we're supposed to thank God for both the Tov and the Ra. I think that what Rabbi Lew is sharing with us here is exactly that. Mm-hmm. And I never thought about that before until you just asked that question, Shosh. So thank you. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
So,
that's,
we don't know what is the Tov and what is the Ra. So 2 years ago on Tu B'Av, perhaps the worst calamity of my life happened. And I said, how could this be the day of love? Well, it turns out that it was a great gift of love. It just came in an ugly package. And I had to move with it, flow with it, to see the blessings unfolding from it. So we don't know what's Tov and what's Ra, and it all flows from God.
What at first seems like a blessing might be a curse. And what at first seems like a curse might be a blessing. Right? And there's a story for that too. Judy Rakusin, I never welcomed you. So with 5 minutes till we come to a close, welcome.
Thank you. So this week I was the victim of a crime. I had mail. I'm a victim of mail theft. So I mailed a check in a blue mailbox in downtown Silver Spring, and somebody broke into the mailbox, took my envelope that had checks in it, altered the checks, and cashed them. Ooh. So number one, be careful about what you put in a blue mailbox. This is apparently a trend. But beyond that, it's made me think about the causes and conditions that led the person to break into the mailbox and commit this crime. And I don't know, when you talk about what is the Tov and what is the Ra, I, you know, fortunately there are banks that investigate this stuff and will likely reimburse me for my losses. But there is part of me that wonders about the criminal and the situation that led that person to do that, and whether there's some compassion to be given to whatever the causes and conditions are that led to them doing it. So.
Well, first, I'm sorry this happened, Judy. And secondly, you are a tremendously compassionate and open-hearted person to express your reaction to all of this in that way, and have modeled for us a godliness. So thank you for that. And I hope it all turns out well in the end. And speaking of endings, that was a pretty good segue, wasn't it? If I might say so for myself. We're going to stop right here. We're going to end with Reb Zalman singing us out with Sim Shalom. Anyone have one takeaway? Let's get a few. What's one takeaway from tonight?
I just wanted to say I like your shirt.
Thank you, Scott. It's Renee's favorite shirt, so you're in good company. Renee, by the way, is in Montana as we speak, heading towards Glacier Park National Park. Thank you, Scott. You totally circumvented my question and threw me for a loop. Anyone, a takeaway from tonight? One word, one sentence. We've kind of touched upon it all going as we went along. Mary Appel.
I like the line, on this journey, our soul will awaken to itself. And I look forward to the next 7 weeks to share this journey with you all and the richness of what that awakened soul would mean to all of us.
Amen the amen. Deborah?
My takeaway tonight is I always look at things in terms of energy, or feel or sense things in terms of energy and exchanges. And I belong here now, and I can talk like that. Thank you.
Thank you. Yay. All righty. So until next time, hopefully for many of us, it'll be Shabbos morning. Jenaba, where are you, my friend?
As we say in Roma Move, yeah. Brooklyn!
Well, yeah. I have one word for you. Forget about it. Well, welcome. You're welcome to join us anytime with your kitty, especially with your kitty, because we have an animal parade during Adon Olam on every Shabbos morning. Bring your kitty with you. All righty. On that note, Laila Tov, everyone. Laila Tov, thank you, everyone. And ma'am?